Good morning to the ninth day of our 21-day program on human rights education. Today is our successful commencement of the ninth day. We have two sessions this morning. The first session will be on freedom of expression as a human right, followed by another session on freedom of association and assembly as a human right. Both of these are very, very relevant. I'm sure the time that is provided is very, very short for the subject matter. But as you all know, this is an introductory course, and therefore we have to do so. We could not have got a better person to do this than the acceptance from Advocate Nagasaila, who is there right before you, who practices law at the Madras High Court in Chennai. I have always heard her and her husband, Dr. V. Suresh, who incidentally is the present General Secretary of the People's Union for Civil Liberties in this country, both of them telling me that their inspiration is and has always been in law and human rights, Mr. K.G. Kanabaran, whose daughter, incidentally, is on the screen on the next speaker in this session. I must, while introducing Saila, must also speak about the partnership between Saila and Suresh as well, because it all goes together. Both of them go together. She herself specializes in labor and environmental law and engages in the Madras High Court on a variety of matters relating to civil liberties, matters against fighting state violence, custodial issues, etc. In addition to her work along with Dr. Suresh in the High Court as practicing advocates, she along with him has also authored several books. The first is perhaps the Death Penalty in India, study of the Supreme Court judgments on death penalty ranging from 1950 to 2006, brought out by Amnesty International. A textbook on criminal law are some of the examples that we can give you. The Harrisbury's Law on Indian Penal Code, which was revised by both of them. Both of them contributed for 10 long years to a column in the Hindu titled Legal File. And she is also associated with the Center for Law, Policy and Human Rights Studies, founded by Dr. Suresh. Now, I recall on the first or the second day about a lecture series that Saila and Suresh, both advocates from Chennai, are doing titled Bringing Home the Constitution. And it is a lecture series where I think now four of the series are over on understanding the Constitution, understanding law and society. And she was just whispering to me that it is on YouTube, and you should be able to also listen to it. I had introduced one of our participants, Nidhi, if I remember her name, from Delhi, who works with Quill Foundation, who had also sent in the contacts for this lecture series that both of them are doing, which is bringing them almost 500 to 600 people listening to it for the last four occasions when they were doing the course. So here you have, friends, I take pride in introducing such people, because these are our living models of people, not only living human rights, breathing human rights, but also fighting for human rights. A couple, a family, which has committed itself to working within the parameters of law, but extending it to writing, to fighting civil liberties in the country, to the People's Union for Civil Liberties, and standing in solidarity with a number of people who require their services, almost often pro bono. Saila, thank you very much for being with us. I will now welcome you to this audience, and the floor is yours. for the next 30 minutes, and then we will have a short question and answer, after which we will have the second lecture that will follow. Over to you, Shaila.
Thank you, Henry. And thank you for the kind words. So let's see if we can. Now, as I understand, of the last 9 days, you have been having these lectures. So it's important to understand, since we are on the subject of free speech and expression, for last 9 days, how is it that so many people across the country came and spent 30 minutes, 1 hour speaking on various issues concerning human rights? What is it that has prompted all of them to come and volunteer their time and share their experiences and knowledge with everybody? That is a very important expression of free speech. Now, we also know that in our currently with the social media, you have YouTubers who put up their various shows from comedy to creative work, songs, or if it is just these influencers. So there are a whole lot of people who are on YouTube every day putting up whatever they feel committed to or they are interested in. Now, publication is something. I mean, there is so much of self-publication that happens in this country. It's not everybody who will have an Oxford University Press or Sales coming and making your publication. So you have people who put in their own money to publish. In fact, some of them put their entire retirement benefits to publish. Now, today with online publishing, I think it's much more economical. Now, what is it that is prompting everybody to spend so much time, energy, effort, resources to express themselves? So very clearly, there is something which is related to human fulfillment, which is closely associated with the right to free speech and expression. So this is a very important value of free speech. Now, free speech is not for just lawyers. It is not for litigation in the high courts and the Supreme Courts. It is a value which we as a society require for, and to begin with, as an individual, where all of us exercise it day in and out, knowingly or unknowingly, for the very simple fact of self-fulfillment. Now, I am seeing now, as of now, there are about 180 participants, I can see. Now, for the 9th day continuously, what is prompting so many of you to come here, log in at the right time and be here and listen to all the speeches over the last 9 days? Apart from that, today, during the lockdown, now there are webinars galore. You have on, you name it, on every subject, you have people speaking and a whole host of people listening. Now, what is prompting all these people listening? Well, yes, for the people who are speaking, there is a sense of self-fulfillment. There is a sense of gratification. So you feel good about the entire process. Now, what is it that is prompting all of you to listen to these lectures? So obviously, it is something, while you, there is a search for knowledge. There is a desire to learn. There is a desire to understand. So this is the second important social value that free speech and expression is fulfilling, which is knowledge sharing and, in a way, searching for truth. All of us want to understand, what is it all about? When there was COVID, all of us are online trying to understand about COVID. So it is about science, it is about technology, it is about art, it is about law. So it is various branches of knowledge which all of us are seeking to understand, because we want to understand, gain knowledge, and through the acquiring of knowledge, we also want to arrive at the truth. Whatever is the truth, it could be the relative truth. Nothing is absolute truth. But so that is also the second value of the free speech and expression. Now, let us look at what is this third important value. We are all, I mean, all this is possible because we are living in a democracy. Now, why is it that all of us want to know about the Constitution? Why do you want to know about the right to free speech and expression? Because we would like to, we as a democracy, we should realize that only if we are aware of all these things, that we as citizens can be proactive, we can make this democracy work, and we can participate in the entire decision-making process. Maybe not directly, but in our own little ways, you can create public opinion, we could be a pressure group, we could just be a knowledge sharing group where we collate data and present it to the people so that opinions can be made in an informed way. So this is again a third value that the freedom of speech and expression carries. I thought that I would emphasize that what is important is that these various classes on human rights is not for lawyers and is not confined to courts. It is something which is part of our society. So that is something which I would like to drive home, that unless we as citizens are proactively involved in human rights and proactively articulate the rights language and use the rights language, as a democracy, we will not grow. And it is very dangerous to leave rights to the business of courts and lawyers, because the logic and the operation of courts is in a different realm over which ordinary citizens have no control. But it is in the social sphere that democracy works, and it is in this sphere that all these rights become very, very valuable. So the third value is that it has, as I have said, that it helps us to be part of this, to be a part of this participative democracy and to make it a real democracy. Now, all these processes, now these are all interdependent. It is not, none of these are standalone, because from the individual self-fulfillment to knowledge seeking and truth to participative democracy, all these are interdependent and one goes hand in hand with the other. Now, what does all this add up to as a society? It will help us to be a much more informed society, much more pluralistic society, and as a society to be tolerant of diverse views, like free speech and expression. Now, what I may say may not be acceptable to somebody else, but it is important to recognize that everybody has a right to speak their mind. Now, we may disagree, but how do we disagree in a manner which is peaceful? How are we tolerant of various diverse ideas? All this, how do you bring about such kind of a tolerant society, or a society which is accepting, which goes beyond tolerance? How do we as a society willing to live and accommodate diverse views, diverse competing interests? Now, if we need to achieve that kind of society, then free speech and expression, informed debate, knowledge sharing, and acceptance becomes a very important part of being a society, as a society, a much more complete society. So this is the fourth value that the right to freedom of speech and expression would fulfill. Now, as you may have been told in the various other classes, that fundamental rights is essentially our constitution, and the part three is vis-a-vis the state, because the state, it is all, we can enforce it against the state. But is the role of fulfilling these rights limited to the state? Even if there is no law which bans a book, or there's no law which prevents people from speaking, is that a sufficient safeguard? Because it is, as far as many exercise of many rights are concerned, the state is not the sole arbiter. Society plays a very, very important part. Social compulsions, social pressures. And so it makes, forms a very important part of the exercise of the enjoyment of any of our fundamental rights. So when we are looking at social pressures, now what, for instance, for people in Tamil Nadu, you might be aware of the author Perumal Murugan and his book, where there was a lot of pressure on him to withdraw certain passages, essentially, which was the crux of his issue, because people objected to the fact that it is, disrespectful of the women of a particular caste. And so it led to the author saying that the author Perumal Murugan is dead. So, which is essentially a curtailment of his fundamental rights. You didn't have the law there. You didn't have the government's banning his book. But what the government did not do, society could effectively do. And he, in fact, said that I will voluntarily withdraw this book. So what does it lead to? It leads to self-censorship. So which is, in fact, more dangerous. If it is a state, it is something which is more direct, which is visible, and we can confront or we can agitate it in courts. But when you have a society and your immediate peer, your neighbors who are hostile, who prevent you from exercising, that is equally dangerous to the exercise of these rights. So that is why I said the values of free speech and expression go beyond the laws. And we as a society if we want to evolve and ensure that we are able to enjoy these rights, it is important that we turn into an informed society and a society tolerant and accepting of diverse views, where reason, rationality, and some kind of empathy is involved in the way we exercise our rights and the way we see it as a value in our society. So now, what are the various factors which would hinder the free speech and expression? Now, if you notice, the Constitution uses the word speech and expression, so which means very clearly it goes beyond speech. The word expression is all encompassing. It talks about all kinds of expression, which could be your art, it could be music, it is theater, it is your Facebook postings, it is your Facebook likes, dislikes, your thumbs up, your thumbs down. All this is part of your free speech and expression. So when you say, so that is why I said that it permeates every part of our life. And we need to be aware that when we talk of the freedom of speech and expression, it means every form of expression, including protest, the right to express dissent, which is a very, very important component of free speech and expression. Now, which is the next major factor which could hamper free speech and expression? It is the economic infrastructure which controls this free speech. Earlier, you had the newsprint, newspapers. Newspapers were controlled by a few big, powerful legal entities. Then today, you have the visual media, the televisions, which is again controlled by a few people. And your entire social media is now no longer in the hands of the state. It is private players who control social media. So how do you regulate all these things? This is where the law comes in, where regulation of social media, for instance, you had the very earliest cases in respect of control of newspapers. You had the Sakal newspapers case. You had the Bennett and Coleman, where the government tried to place restrictions on the number of pages a particular newspaper can print, the number of pages that you can devote towards advertisements. So there, those kind are in later on in Bennett and Coleman case, where the government said that we would limit the quantity of newsprint which would be supplied to newspapers. Now all these things were challenged in the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court said that the state coming in to control or to put these kind of restrictive measures on the economic resources available to these entities is a violation of your right to free speech and expression. Because on the one hand, the newspapers are not able to, of course, interestingly, in both these scenarios, the governments did have, they did say that we want to bring in these restrictions to ensure that there are no monopolies, to ensure that the small players will also have enough freedom to operate, and you will not have the big players elbowing them out. So, while yes, they did say that these are competing interests and we are trying to balance out, but the Supreme Court held by majority that this is really a violation of your free speech and expression. So this, now today we are in the realm of Facebook and Twitter handles, etc. We have had instances of people's accounts being arbitrarily blocked. You had situations where Facebook posts were brought down, or even certain newspapers voluntarily, suddenly certain posts disappear. Recently in Indian Express, an article with regard to the COVID and the manner in which the ICM, the data with regard to the number of, the manner of testing, all this, there was a very critical article on it and it was brought down. So today we are now moving to a different stage where the control of this infrastructure dealing with free speech and expression this is an indirect manner of controlling what is made available. So on the one hand, it is the right of the people who are putting up these posts which is violated, and on the other hand, it is the right of the people to know. So this is an important concomitant right which goes along with the right to free speech and expression, which is the right to know. So Supreme Court has time and again held that your right to free speech and expression becomes meaningless if you also do not have the right to know. It is from this right to information that today you have, I think you already had a session on the Right to Information Act. It is on account of people's demands over decades, saying that we have a right to know, that finally culminated in the passing of the Right to Information Act. I mean, of course, the working of the act and the fact that today it is not functioning in the way it should is a different matter altogether. It is for all of us to see that these laws are not diluted and we are able to enforce it in a proper way. But what I would like to impress upon you is that the right to freedom of speech and expression and the right to know are the two sides of the coin. So one goes hand in hand, because what is it that we are able to speak unless we also know? We are just not here to just, you know, blabber something which is incoherent. It is not just about making the noises and the sounds. It is about being able to exchange ideas, exchange views, to have discussions. And these discussions are possible only when information is available to the public at large. So freedom of speech and expression and the right to know go hand in hand. And that is why it is important now to also look at net neutrality, to ensure that the space within the social media is not constrained. And that is why, as citizens, we should be very alert to these developments, even in the world of software and networking and all these various Facebook alliances with Reliance. Now that has happened. Now there is a agreement between Reliance and Facebook, and we don't know how it is going to pan out. So, but it is important that we understand that the transparency and the openness of the information infrastructure, the economic infrastructure, is equally important for the exercise of the rights of citizens. Now, having dealt with the role of non-state players, the role of economic infrastructure in the exercise of the rights, because as I said, it is not just for the state alone. You don't need a law, but all these factors have a very, very, in fact, a much more impact, a significant impact on the exercise of our rights and freedoms. I understand that most of the participants here have already been informed about the content of the Article 19(1)(a) and the restrictions in 19(2). So I will not go into each of these restrictions. But what will be important to understand is that what the Constitution contemplates is reasonable restrictions. And both these words are of some significance, because first is the word reasonable. So what do you mean by the word reasonable? When we say it should be reasonable, what we mean, or what the courts have interpreted it over time, is that it should not be excessive. It should not be disproportionate. For instance, if there is somebody here, or if tomorrow the government feels that these human rights lectures, which is being organized by People's Watch, is bad, or if they feel that one particular speaker made some statement which is not acceptable, tomorrow they can't bring in a law saying that hereafter there can be no courses on human rights, because it is very clearly, I mean, of course, I'm saying even that objection to one person saying is also bad, but I'm just to give you a simple understanding of it as to what restrictions can be seen to be reasonable. So the tomorrow the courts or the government cannot bring in a law saying that hereafter human rights courses are banned in this country. They can't say that. Or they cannot say that next time People's Watch or Henry wants to conduct some course like this, every speaker's speech will have to be recorded. You will have to submit it to the closest, nearest police station. And then the sub-inspector there or the inspector there will have to approve of the speeches. And only then you can upload it. That is clearly excessive control, and it is totally costly, disproportionate, and it is not reasonable. So it is important that the Constitution, the words need to be understood, that every word has a meaning, has a significance, and so any restrictions placed should be reasonable. And the next thing is, it is a restriction, it is not a prohibition. So what the Constitution contemplates is that you can restrict, you can regulate, but you cannot entirely prohibit. So that is again an important thing that all of you as persons who want to understand law should bear in mind, that no fundamental right can ever be totally prohibited or banned, and what is permissible is a reasonable restrictions, and all your various clauses in 19, 19(2), 3, 4, 5, 6 are all restrictive clauses which places limitations They all have to be reasonable and they can regulate, but they can never entirely prohibit, no matter what the views of the ruling party or the government may be. Now, one of the main, as far as restrictions are concerned, interestingly, it is the right to free speech and expression, which has the largest list of limitations or restrictions, which is beginning from security of state, sovereignty, national integrity, public order, incitement to commit an offense, morality, defamation. So the restrictions, if you notice that if the other freedoms don't have as many restrictions as free speech has. So obviously the state is very wary of citizens, one having the right to know and the right to free speech. So that is why the governments have, and even the constitution makers, felt that this right has to be very closely regulated, and hence brought in as many as 6 different restrictions. But while I will not go into each one of them for paucity of time, because it's already 9:26, so in the next 4 minutes I would like to quickly run through, I would like to club the main restrictions all dealing with the state, which is your, in the interests of, I mean, your free speech can be curtailed in the interests of sovereignty and integrity of India, security of state, friendly relations with foreign states, public order, and incitement to an offense, because I've clubbed it with the others, because all that relates to state offenses, etc. Because various provisions of the Indian Penal Code or your Unlawful Assemblies Act or your sedition laws, all these will come into operation. Now, how do you understand these things? Does it mean that any criticism of the existing government, any sort of displeasure at what is happening today, like people may have criticism about the way the lockdown has been managed. People may have criticism about the various economic packages which have been announced. Some may feel that these economic packages are no relief at all. What about the migrant labor who are now walking? We may all be very unhappy about it. Now, when we express our dissatisfaction, our displeasure against all these things, can the state say that this is threatening the sovereignty and integrity of India by criticizing the government on the management of COVID? Can you say that it is affecting the security of the state? Can you say that it is affecting public order, or it is inciting people by criticizing the government? You are creating unrest, and it is going to encourage people to commit offenses or to turn against the government. Is it possible to say that? So the courts, which have taken inspiration from the courts in the United States, they have said that it is not just any remote tendency for people at some point in time in distant future that, people may rally around and, they may oppose, and hence it is you need to restrict it. What the courts have said that is that whatever the threats should be something which is immediate and which should be imminent. Now, if you, I would just like to give one example in the case of Rangarajan versus, I think, Jagjeevan, where it was in the context of a film which was made. The entire film was against the reservation policy, where an upper caste person gets a false scheduled caste certificate, becomes an IAS officer, but a very honest and a very efficient IAS officer. But obviously later on comes to light that she got the IAS, she got into the IAS by giving a false certificate, and then she is prosecuted. And the film culminates in her questioning the entire, incidentally it is a woman officer, and she argues about the unfairness of the reservation system and how it is keeping out meritorious candidates, etc. So there was a big uproar in Tamil Nadu saying that it is, something which the upper caste has brought in, and it is anti-reservation, and there were a lot of protests. And the film, though it was certified by the censor board and got the certification, was not permitted to be screened. And the Madras High Court said, well, it is going to create a lot of public order and law and order situation, and so we are going to ban the film. And this was taken up to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court said, people may express, opinions which are not acceptable to a large section, but the duty of the state is to protect and ensure that and to facilitate the expression of these opinions rather than curtail it. And they said that unless it is something like, you know, lighting a match, you know, that the term used is a spark in the powder keg. So unless the speech, the expression is something which is going to light a spark in the powder keg, that is, it's immediately it will lead to an explosion. It will immediately lead to some riotous situation. Unless the danger is so imminent and so immediate, you cannot say that today expressing something is likely to create something in the future sometime, in the unforeseen future, is no reason to curtail any of these rights. And the other restrictions with regard to defamation and morality, again, morality is something which is very debatable. Morality changes with times. We have seen the Supreme Court striking down 377. So from the Victorian, morals to the current day, 21st century morality, it is something which is constantly changing. So it is again very subjective. And then defamation. Today, defamation is being used by the corporates to silence social activists. You have what is called the slap litigation, which is the strategic litigation against public participation, where environmental activists, human rights activists, or people who expose corruption. In Tamil Nadu, you have the Arapor, who had a string, about 10 defamation cases filed by various contractors because they exposed corruption. And then you had very many human rights activists, Greenpeace, organizations who have had to face litigation saying that by criticizing them, you are defaming us. And such courts have held that if you are able to establish that you have enough material to establish the truth of these allegations, then you cannot sue them for defamation, and it would in fact be a violation of your free speech and expression, and that is not what is contemplated by the Constitution. So to sum up, we must understand that free speech and expression is not something which is stagnant. It is not something which can be left to the state to entirely moderate. It is something which each one of us should be alive to, should be alert to, and facilitate, because your neighbor's free speech is dependent on your tolerance and your acceptance of the diverse views. So as a society, the exercise of these rights is dependent, and the preservation of these rights is dependent on each one of us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Shaila. Without wasting time, is it Matthew or Rajivel on the questions today?
I'm here.
Yes, Matthew.
Yeah, there have been a lot of questions, but I've tried to summarize few of them. I will put forward three main issues which participants ask about. One is with regard to the government using sedition to curb free expression. I repeat, governments using sedition to curb free expression. Second is they would like to know about the whole issue of hate speech, maybe in brief, and how it violates dignity of an individual or the entire community. And a third question, is the right to free speech and expression only available for Indian citizens or also for refugees who are residing in India or foreign nationals? Thank you.
Okay, sedition is definitely a matter of big concern, because today sedition is being used for the smallest of things, from student agitation, the recent CAA protests, to you name it today, from students agitating for rise in fee hike or unfair admissions or opposing NEET or environmental activists, you have sedition which is being used. So this is in a way taking the seriousness of the entire issue of sedition, because that was not what was contemplated in law. When you're looking at sedition, you are looking at something which is going to, threaten the very, infrastructure of the state, where you are trying to overthrow the state. And I don't think our state is so fragile that any protest anywhere, any criticism, it is going to collapse. Then there is something wrong with the way our democracy is, and why our state should be feeling so vulnerable. So, yes, there are a lot of activists who are inside today who have not got bail. Unfortunately, the courts are also equally taken up by this entire discourse on, false nationality and false patriotism. which is been even swallowed by them. And so the moment the word sedition is seen in the FIR, even courts don't want to touch it with a barge pole, and they are also hesitant. We have had, now we have Sudha Bharadwaj who's inside, you have now Gautam Navlaika, and then you Anand Teltumble, and the other people with the Bhima Koregaon who are all inside for no reason at all. And yes, it is a very, very serious threat. There is a demand that the sedition law should be out of the statute. It has no place in independent India. Unfortunately, many of the colonial legacies we are continuing into free India. And so, yes, sedition, in fact, PUCL did start a campaign that sedition law should be repealed. And I think it is time that once again we take this debate forward and ensure that sedition law is repealed. Now, hate speech, as I said, it works both ways. Yes, hate speech is very problematic. It is very hurting. And it can make people in the minorities, whether you are a minority in terms of religious minorities, linguistic minorities, or minorities in terms of the current thinking. But we should again be very careful that the problems of hate speech should not lead us to banning speech altogether, because that is a big danger that we will all, it's a trap that all of us can fall into, because in our anxiety to curtail hate speech, we may end up curtailing speech altogether. So here, this is where the initial values that I was speaking about is very important, that what is required to prevent hate speech or to control hate speech is informed debate. So what is required is more speech, more debate, and not curtailment of speech if we want to deal with hate speech. And the third thing is with regard to citizens, whether the freedom of speech and expression is curtailed to citizens. Yes, Article 19 is restricted to citizens. Only it's 14 and 21 which is available to persons as a whole. And again, when the word citizen is concerned, there's one aspect which I would like to point out more from a very legalistic point, that when you, since the word used is citizen, it is not available to corporates. Now the word person includes corporates and legal entities, whereas citizen, so for instance, a Reliance or any other industrial house cannot claim, or Facebook cannot claim that my right to free speech and expression is being violated because, restrictions placed, because corporates do not enjoy free speech and expression. But having said that, what I would like to bring to your attention is a recent judgment of the Calcutta High Court with regard to the exercise of rights by a foreigner, by a foreign student. I think it was a Polish student who was sought to be deported because he had participated in some of these CAA agitations. And even in Tamil Nadu, we had a German student of IIT who participated in the CAA rally. He carried a poster saying that we have seen it, we have been there. Obviously meaning the fascist regime and what they have gone through during the Nazi regime. And so he says, we have been there, we know what it means, and so please don't get there. So he held a banner and he just walked. That's all that he did. But the government of India wanted to deport him, and the German student didn't want to challenge it. He didn't want to take the risk of landing up in prison in India and face the consequences of it. And so he just left. But the Polish student did challenge it in the Calcutta High Court. And then the Calcutta High Court said, well, Article 19 may be available to only citizens, but Article 21 and 14 is available to foreigners. And when you say Article 21, today the Constitution of India, the Supreme Court has expanded 21 to include the right to live with dignity. And they said that when a student comes here, and when his right to life and liberty is protected, and when right to life and liberty includes the right to live with dignity, and dignity includes to articulate, to speak, to be able to, because after all, human dignity involves free speech. And so they read into Article 21 the right to free speech and said that even a foreigner could exercise, and so hence, deporting him on these grounds is not valid, and then hence they struck out. Of course, they also went into the fact that he was not given an opportunity and sense, it is a violation of Article 14. It's an arbitrary exercise of power, and they struck it down. But anyway, this has, I'm sure it will be taken up. It is a single judge order. It may probably go up on appeal to a division bench and subsequently to the Supreme Court. But it is a very, very interesting and a progressive interpretation of whether 19 is now only applicable to foreigners or, I mean, to citizens, or whether it can be extended to other non-citizens. Yeah.
So, Shaila, I verified we are well within time. We have checked also the questions. We don't have questions. I think for the participants, it was a good occasion for us to... it was not only on free expression, but of speech and expression, but also reminding us back into what these sessions are for, reminding us what the definition of human rights is. It is on the right to life, on equality, liberty within which all what we discussed falls, and dignity of the individual. And the last judgment was the linkages made between right to life, dignity, and expression. So I think that linkage was also made up in not only in the presentation, but also in the answer to the questions that were posed. Thank you, Shaila, for having been with us. I know 30 minutes is too small for you, too short for you. I've seen you through your 1.5 hour patient, quiet presentation. None of us can do that. You just had that towel in your the handkerchief in your hand, and that was it. Really admired you through your sessions, and I would like to use this occasion for all participants. We will send it in our WhatsApp today for those who want further lectures, want to listen to further lectures, want to be part of lectures on constitution, on constitution law. Although you would have missed the four, tomorrow is the day. It's on Wednesdays and Saturdays. Mark your days, Wednesdays and Saturdays. Now, none of you can have an excuse not to be there. You can't bluff us saying you've got a lecture after that. You can't say that you've got something very important to do because it is from 8 p.m. to 10 p.m. So all that you can do is listen to Suresh and Shaila and then go to sleep. That's the maximum you can do. I will send, I'll make sure we send it again in the group for those who are interested, so that this whole quest for more knowledge on the Constitution, laws and society will continue also through your series, which will continue past our series. Thank you very much, Shaila. Now, let us start 3 minutes early, Kalpana. Lucky you are. We've never had this kind of a lucky situation. Both of them are very close friends, as you will see. So, you will find a lot of informality that goes on here, because I think we all belong to a larger family of people who have been brought together by a number of people who have been our mentors. And therefore, this informality. Now, I have the pleasure of inviting into our midst Dr. Professor Kalpana Kannabiran from Hyderabad. We have known each other for many years as well. She presently is the professor of sociology and director in the Council for Social Development in Hyderabad, which is an autonomous research institute supported by the Indian Council of Social Science and Research. She is a proud recipient of the Amartya Sen Award for Distinguished Social Scientist for her work in the discipline of law in its inaugural year, in the year 2012. She has also been awarded the BKRV Rao Prize for Social Science Research in the field of social aspects of law by the ICSSR in the year 2003. Kalpana has been the founding faculty of Nalsar University of Law on the outskirts of Hyderabad, where she taught sociology and law for almost a decade. She is the co-founder of Asmita Resource Center for Women, set up in 1991, where she designed and coordinated the legal services and outreach program. She has introduced far-reaching academic initiatives in the Council for Social Development, Southern Regional Center, based in Hyderabad. We would like you to visit their website. Her work has focused on understanding the social foundations of non-discrimination, structural violence, and questions of constitutionalism and social justice in India, with a specific focus on gender, sexual minorities, caste, Adivasi indigenous rights, and disability rights. In addition to all this, she is a frequent contributor, just as we saw the earlier speaker being, to the Economic and Political Weekly and a member of the editorial advisory group for the Review of Women's Studies. She also writes for the Hindu and the Wire regularly. She was a member of the expert group on the Equal Opportunity Commission of the Government of India in 2007-2008, which has come out with a detailed report. She is the General Secretary of the Indian Association for Women's Studies. She was a member of the Executive Committee of the International Sociological Association for the years 14 to 18. She has been closely associated with a number of civil society organizations in the country and has worked very closely with NAVO, the National Alliance of Women's Organizations in India, of which Ruth was the convener, and contributed to the three alternative CEDAW reports from India, which we spoke of in that session. We are thankful to Kalpana for having accepted to be with us. It's not easy to get all these people. They do us a favor by being here. And we are thankful to you, Kalpana, for having accepted this invitation. Over to you for the next 30 minutes on freedom of association and assembly are also human rights, something that all of us, day in and day out, are facing with the number of criminal cases that we are carrying on our shoulders. Thank you.
Thank you, Henry, and thank you to IHRE for this invitation, and also thank you very much to all the participants in this course. We have about 192 here. For your interest in human rights and for your interest in particularly in the question of human rights at this historical juncture. And I think that that is really for me the most important part of the course. Of course, there was a kind of sense of deja vu. You couldn't do anything else. You are stuck in a lockdown, and so one has to communicate, and an online platform is an effective way of doing that. But I think what is also really important for me is the coincidence, the fact that this opportunity, this prolific opportunity, like Shaila said before me, there are hundreds of lectures and courses and Facebook Live events and so on that are going on, that this prolific opportunity has actually come at this particular time. And I will, in the course of what I say, open out what I mean by this particular time and why I think that the timing of this, while not intentional, is still extremely significant. In speaking about the right to freedom of association and assembly, I'm not actually going to be focusing on the law so much. I understand that you already have some familiarity with that, but also that I would urge you to go back, those of you who are interested in the legal interpretations around association and assembly, I would urge you to go back and study that more closely. As somebody who's primarily a sociologist and engaged with participating in and studying social movements, I have never been a practicing lawyer. I do not, what my interest really is in looking at what I call the constitution as commons. Some of you might be familiar with the work of Elinor Ostrom, who won the Nobel Prize for Economics for her work on the commons. And there is a vast scholarship that looks at the commons as something that must be equally available to all people, that must be available on a shared basis, that must be mutually regulatory, not regulated top-down by the state, that must be suffused with community participation, and that must be informed with a community understanding. So if we say that the commons, the attributes of the commons very broadly are those, then what is important for me is to understand the constitution as a commons. It is not the property of courts, like Shaila pointed out. It's not a property of courts. It's not a property of lawyers. It is something that is equally shared, enjoyed, and owned by all of us collectively and together. And by all of us, I mean all citizens of this country, all persons resident in this country who share an understanding of a shared humanity. And there are, of course, legalistic separations within the Constitution, but even those, as Shaila pointed out in the Calcutta case, can quite easily, through an interpretive strategy, be extended beyond citizens to persons resident in the country. So we are talking about the basis of a shared humanity. Now, so that very briefly then is the ground on which I situate my observations on the right to freedom of association and assembly. You are all familiar with Article 19 of the Constitution, and 19.1a speaks of the freedom of speech and expression, which we've just heard a very eloquent detailing of from Shaila. It speaks of the right to assemble peaceably and without arms, to form associations and unions, to move freely throughout the territory of India, and to reside and settle in any part of the territory of India. And you will see that each of these has a specificity. So of course, the right to assemble peaceably and you know, the right to form, the right to associational freedoms and assembly is something that I will specifically open out. But in terms of a more a more intersectional reading of the section, what we also see today, during the COVID lockdown, and I would like to make that connection in the context of Article 19, is a curtailment of the right to move freely through the territory of India. We see what is happening with the migrants. We see what is happening with workers. We see criminalization of mobility. We see borders being set up between states. In the imaginary of the current national government, every state sees itself as a microcosm of Bharat Mata, and every neighboring state is an enemy state. So you are actually barricading neighboring states and barricading returning migrants from neighboring states, or migrants who need to transit through a state to reach their home state. Despite the fact that under Article 19, you have an explicit and stated fundamental right to reside and settle in any part of the territory of India for any length of time. This can be temporary, it can be transitory, can be for livelihood, it can be permanent, it can be anything, but you have the right to move within the territory of India. So, but I think in trying to understand Article 19, and in fact, for me, that is the only way in which I've actually been able to understand the Constitution, is to look at the specific ways in which it speaks to the everyday, to the everyday lived experience that we go through and that we witness. Also, for in looking at assembly and association, the one aspect that I would like to underscore is the indivisibility of this section. So for the sake of convenience, we might actually separate free speech from the right to assembly, from the right to form associations, from the right to mobility, and so on. But in fact, all the components of 19 are indivisible. But you also have the fact that if we go by what the Calcutta High Court said, and then we see that in the context of the expansive right to privacy judgment of 2017, we will also have an understanding of the indivisibility of the Constitution itself, that you can't just disaggregate it completely in your understanding into component parts that are unrelated to each other. And for this, we need to understand the framework of the Constitution. And I really like an expression that Justice Sudarshan Reddy uses in a 2010 case, where he talks about the triadic ethical framework of the Constitution, where he is actually saying that you can't view the Constitution in piecemeal terms, that the preamble is intricately connected to Part 3, which is the Fundamental Rights chapter, which is again intricately connected to Part 4, which is the Directive Principles of State Policy. And what we are now seeing in the entire migrant crisis is a complete abdication of state responsibility with reference to Part 4, which is the Directive Principles of State Policy. So if we look at Article 19 then, as situated within this composite and integrated understanding of the Constitution. And we see the preamble, because Article 19 itself, you know, in its bare text, none of the fundamental rights, except perhaps 15, none of the fundamental rights are explicit in detail. 15 is detailed, and Article 17, which is the ban on untouchability, is categorical. And so in that sense, complete. So apart from 15 and 17, all the rest are kind of telescoped statements that are then subject to interpretation. But in interpreting that, I think what really gives it meaning is the preamble. And I'm sure you've gone through the preamble already, but just to contextualize what I'm saying, and it also comes into my discussion on the right to the freedom of association and assembly, I will read the preamble out to you very quickly. We, the people of India, having solemnly resolved to constitute India into a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic, and to secure to citizens justice, social, economic, and political, liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith, and worship, equality of status and of opportunity, and to promote among them all fraternity, assuring the dignity of the individual and the unity and integrity of the nation. Now, if you go back to Article 19, and you look at the Article 19 as the protection of certain rights, particularly the right to assemble peaceably and without arms, and to form associations and unions. To assemble peaceably and without arms, for what? It is the preamble that gives you the framework for that. You may assemble peaceably and without arms for furthering the ends of justice, social justice, economic justice, political justice. You can form political parties. You can form trade unions. You can have groups that seek social reform, or groups that are formed to resist against social injustice. For instance, Adivasi rights, Dalit rights, minority rights, women's rights, transgender rights, disability rights are all associational forms that speak specifically to questions of justice. The question of liberty, of thought, expression, belief, faith, and worship. I have the right to practice the freedom of religion. I have the right to the freedom of conscience. So I can be an atheist. I can be an agnostic. I can belong to any religious faith that I like. And I can express myself in the manner that I think is most effective in communicating my ideas. And that's something, again, that we went through with Shaila. I can exercise my right to the freedom of association and assembly in order to further the goals, the preambular goals of the equality of status and opportunity. So any association, any attempt to form an association or to assemble in order to address questions of inequality, in order to address questions of discrimination, particularly discrimination as set out in Article 15, discrimination as set out in Article 17, discrimination as set out in Article 16, discrimination as set out in Article 23, whether it's forced labor, child labor, environmental rights, Adivasi rights. The equality of status and opportunity in the preamble actually points us towards what possible ways do we have in front of us that we might actually organize on the basis of to make this country a better place to live in, to further the goals of what Dr. Ambedkar called constitutional morality, to further the goals of an ethical constitutionalism. So the fundamental basis really for Article 19 rights is the is the promotion of the ethical framework of the Constitution. You of course have the question of rights brought before courts in terms of individual litigants vis-a-vis the state, or individual groups or particular groups vis-a-vis the state. But what I would like us to understand Article 19 as is in the broadest sense, how do each of us as citizens of this country enjoy and understand the right to assembly and association? Also, as Shaila said, there is a whole jurisprudence of restrictions and the curtailment of rights, the leniency of courts on questions of sedition, their unwillingness to curtail Arnab Goswami's hateful, insightful programs on TV, but their willingness to curtail speech, right to free speech and association of the Kabir Kalamanch, for instance, putting them all in prison, gives us an idea of where sedition has traveled. So it is no longer sedition. What are the interests of the state? The interests of this, the paramount interest of the state is to promote a constitutional order. So if the Kabir Kalamanch is speaking, or the Bhima Koregaon protests are speaking or exercising, and associational freedoms are completely intertwined inseparably with free speech and expression. So if Bhima Koregaon events or the Kabir Kalamanch is speaking of the annihilation of caste. Now, the annihilation of caste is a constitutional goal under Article 17 of the Constitution. It comes under Part 3, which is a justiciable right. Now, if they're speaking under in furtherance of Article 17 and Article 21 of the Constitution, how is that construed as against the interests of the state and hence sedition? And if Arnab Goswami is repeating in his entire TV channels, and he is seen and recorded as repeating words like Corona Jihad and some other jihad and targeting Muslims in the most violent manner, or if Kapil Mishra is actually on video inciting crowds again to violence against Muslims, how is that then not seen as against state interest? So I think what we need to understand is that Article 19 rights are tied to Article 21, but you can't understand any of these rights absent a political commitment to the furthering of the goals of the Constitution. Because if you don't have that political commitment, and I'm sorry, but in the recent cases that have come before the Supreme Court has actually demonstrated a lack of commitment to these goals. Because you in fact have the Supreme Court saying that they cannot gag the press when they're asked to rule on Arnab Goswami's specific identified programs, but they are unwilling to, to consider questions of free speech related to protesters against the Citizenship Amendment Act, or protesters who were involved in the Bhima Koregaon issues. Also people like Gautam Navlakha and Anand Teltumbre and so on. So there is a very, the anti-political way is also a deeply political way, because you are then promoting the status quo. There is a very anti-political way in which the Supreme Court has approached the question of associational freedoms and its linkages with free speech. And I would just like to place one point before you, before I go on to a set of illustrations of how we understand associational freedoms. So when we talk about associational freedoms, are we talking about the right to assemble on any and every issue, or are we talking about the right to associate in a manner that subserves the Constitution and that furthers constitutional goals? And this is really always a dilemma before us. I don't have an answer, but it is a dilemma. Because, for instance, we had the massacre of Dalits in Chundur in 1991. That massacre was preceded by close to 400 members of the dominant caste meeting, planning the massacre, going together in concert and attacking and hacking Dalits to death. Is that assembly protected? I think not. In Baithani Tola, similarly, we had the upper castes getting together and going and massacring Dalits. Is that assembly of upper castes permitted? I think not. We had the incident of Melavalavu in Tamil Nadu. So was that assembly protected by the right to freedom of assembly? My answer would be no. We had Muhammad Akhlaq dragged out of his home and killed by a group of dominant caste Hindutva men of a particular political formation. Was that assembly protected by Article 19? No. We had the riots in Muzaffarnagar. Was that assembly protected? So I think that when we, the most difficult and the more the ones on which we really need to take a decision is on these forms of assembly that are clearly violative of the constitutional spirit, of constitutional protections, of the constitutional ethos, and of the fundamental tenets of the triadic ethical framework of the Constitution. So we, at some level, it is important for us not to broaden the idea of the right to association by encompassing the right to perpetrate violence based on structural discrimination or the right to perpetrate structural violence, because structural violence on grounds of discrimination is explicitly proscribed under the Constitution. So I think that that is really, which is why, this is really the reason why I started off with saying that one cannot view the fundamental rights contained in the Constitution in a disaggregated way. So you can't just pluck Article 19 freedoms out and say these must be applied on their own. They are not silos. They are tied to other parts of the Constitution. And it is other protections in the Constitution that in fact inform the reading of a particular right. The other part of 19 that I really wanted to also flag, and I want to also flag it in the context of a particular judgment that has come out of the Supreme Court recently on the employment of non-scheduled tribe teachers in the Schedule 5 areas. There is a provision in Article 19, which is 19.5, which says that there is nothing that shall prevent the state from making any law or imposing reasonable restrictions for the protection of the interests of the scheduled tribes. Because you know that Schedule 5 areas have constantly been run over by non-tribal populations who have marginalized the scheduled tribes more. And that is an important part. It is an important inbuilt restriction on the right to freedom of movement that links up with Schedules 5 and 6 of the Constitution. From here, I actually want to move very quickly, although I'm almost out of time. I will take another 10 minutes, Henry. I want to actually move to specific instances that to me demonstrate the strength of the right to freedom of association. So we saw the arrest of Dalit leader Chandrasekhar Azad, the founder of the Bhim Army, a few months ago. The charge was that Azad was making inflammatory speeches against the government before a huge gathering of anti-CAA protesters. What was his offense? He was reading the preamble of the Constitution before a large crowd of CAA protesters who had gathered in the Jama Masjid. And when he went up for bail, the judge actually asked the state what his offense was. And the state said that he was inciting the crowd to violence. And the judge observed, was he reading the preamble of the Constitution? Was that his offense? Is that why you are charging him with incitement? And then went on to say, I may observe that for judges, legal persons, and officers under the Constitution of India is a sacred document. And if this is correct, reading this document cannot prima facie be taken as incitement. And this is something that actually spreads across all the anti-CAA protests, because one common feature that you found in the exercise of the freedom of association in the context of the anti-CAA protests in the last year and this year was the public reading of the Constitution. The second part of the right to freedom of association that I then want to skip to, is the ways in which freedom of association in fact facilitates the practice of politics, and it facilitates the performance of the Constitution as commons. And I want to draw your attention to 4 years ago, to Rohit Vemula's struggle and his setting up of the Veliwada in the University of Hyderabad, to protest against the anti-Dalit, anti-minority politics and practices within institutions of higher education. Now, that struggle that Rohit began and that he died for is a struggle that has spread to campuses across the country in very different ways. So you have the right to assembly and association finding expression in a most vibrant and educative manner in campuses, in the University of Hyderabad, in JNU, in Jamia, in Aligarh, you have it all over, and in smaller campuses as well. Now, what that in fact does, what the entire movement in campuses has done, is that it has promoted among students, among people in higher education, it has promoted an understanding of the Constitution, which would otherwise be either confined within political science or it would be confined to courts. We have I want to move now to the third example, which is a very unique form of expression of the right to freedom of association and assembly. And in this form, the figure of the Adivasi leader, Abhay Flavian Khaka, who we lost tragically a few months ago, is central. In 2015, the Modi government attempted to push through a bill to amend the right to fair compensation and transparency in Land Acquisition, Rehabilitation and Resettlement Act 2013. And this move would have divested Adivasi communities of land and common resources. So what does Khaka do? He led around 60 Adivasi men. So this is freedom of association and assembly. He led around 60 Adivasi men to go in front of a local government office and publicly defecate on copies of the proposed bill. And when there was a huge reaction, I mean, what is this public defecation on copies of a bill? Khaka's assertion is extremely telling. He says, poop, and I quote his words, poop protest is the most peaceful and democratic protest against a black law which threatens the core of their life, Jal, Jungle, and Jameen. Poop protest is not a new form of agitation. In fact, throughout history, whenever oppressed masses have dropped their shit as arsenal, rulers have been shaken because it often marks the beginning of a social uprising. So you can, in fact, express associational rights and the freedom of assembly in stunningly different ways. The last example that I wanted to take, and I'm actually just going to mention it, and then I will request Rajivel to play the YouTube video that I wanted to play, has to do with Kashmir. We know that it is a state that was locked down long before, but it was locked down formally again in a very different way on August 5th. The state was reduced to 2 union territories. And there have been mass detentions, arrests. I myself was in Kashmir in February and we produced a detailed report of what we saw. On our return to the airport, we were stuck in the site of an encounter and barely made it to the airport. So what you hear is not an exaggeration. It is something that actually happens on a very daily basis. The curtailment of freedoms in Kashmir is completely unimaginable. It is not something that can ever be replicated in India, whatever happens in India is always only a fraction of what has happened in Kashmir. And in an essay last year, Nasir Ghanai, in an essay in The Outlook, in fact says, what will we understand of the right to freedom of assembly and associational freedoms and civic resistance if the groups that resist are called Pellet Blinds Association, Association of the Parents of Disappeared Persons, or Association of Half Widows? So violence, and that brings me to my final point. The most important site for the exercise of the right to freedom of assembly and association, and the most difficult site in which to organize, is where you are confronted with state violence. That is really the most difficult. Trade unions, students' associations, you have any number, environmental associations, you have any number of ways in which one can organize. But when you are confronted with state violence, that is the most critical site for the exercise of the right to freedom of association and assembly. And for this, I actually want to play a 4.5 minute video of what by Kashmiri scholars. It is a song and it has English subtitles, and I would urge you to follow the subtitles because that will give you an indication of what are the sites on which associational freedoms and freedom of assembly need to be exercised in a place that is as embattled as Kashmir. Thank you.
Valyavathya Zalim Chukadun Susahara Chashman mas tele, sinan mas bullet, hadem mas fear, gas in shkutsa, krak, 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 Israeli taki, chutu yaz maman, asti hushmut falastini intifad, Ali Singh Kumbli, Abdullah Tundi, Tundi asim, mufti an hikar, I say as to the hope वैसे हर चीज सुजु एम से गैसे गोशना काम काम का पन्यो बजोनिश तो ही सेन रयु ऐसे लोग चिट्ठे मज इनकलाब दोरा गो कुन्नई गरिश न खबरी जमीनी अस्म सोई मुक्ति दुल्ला की अदाब अशिक्त मशुक कई लुक गई जदा हेरा नैर दिल मशुक इस दिदा अस्वाद बोटा वे अनु टाडा पीए से एम कुद्या लपचा कर बर्बार बार बार मकान सोई जर्यू घरु गुजरोयू तो ते बागन गुर्चुट करा एतिजा
So Henry, I'm done.
They have unmuted me, but I find it difficult to speak. That has been the effect of not only the talk, but of the video. Without wasting time, I pass on to Matthew. Matthew, two questions. It's time, so two questions.
Yeah, thank you, Kalpana, for this very moving presentation. Just two questions out of many which came. How much are the provisions of Article 19 of our Indian Constitution in sync with the international law, or are there any gaps between the both? Second question, which are the laws most used or misused by the state to target protests or protesters? For example, what we are seeing in Delhi and UP with the anti-CA protesters. Thank you.
Yeah. Is Article 19 in sync? For the most part, yes. I mean, like I said, I read out the main part of Article 19.1, and they are very, very broad parameters. So there isn't a conflict between Article 19 and international law, as far as I understand it. On the misuse, you can misuse on using several. We have, like the video on Kashmir showed you, and both Shaila and Henry have been involved with cases on the ground on quota and TADA and so many sedition cases and any number. The provisions that are being used now the most on the anti-CAA protesters, particularly in Delhi and in UP, are either the charge of sedition or under the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, both of which are extremely draconian legislations. And the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, of course, is also the act under which Anand Teltumbde, Gautam Navlakha, and the entire set of people who are now in jail on the Bhima Koregaon case have been put behind the bars under the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. If you look at Kashmir and the northeastern states, it is the Armed Forces Special Powers Act that gives complete impunity to the military. But in Kashmir, you also have the Public Safety Act, which is again a draconian legislation under which we know, of course, that it's the leaders who were placed, the pro-India leaders who were placed under PSA after August 5th, but our own travels in Kashmir have showed us that it's even 19 and 20-year-old boys who have no connection with politics have been placed under PSA in jails in Uttar Pradesh. They've been removed from Kashmir and placed in jails in Uttar Pradesh. So in terms of the, you know, the provisions of the Indian Penal Code, creating a public nuisance, inciting people to violence, you know, you can use the penal code, you can use special legislations, and you can also just arrest, you know, without particular recourse to any particular provision. That's also something that our law enforcement or authorities have perfected over the years, that you manufacture the reason for arrest after the arrest has been made. So preemptive arrests are also extremely, you know, common and widely used. The point is, you know, it's also a moving target. So I think what we need to really focus on quite centrally is the right to protest, the right to assemble, and the right, the full, you know, the full robust exercise of associational freedoms.
Thank you. Henry, you can come in now. You have to unmute your mic.
The last question that our participants had asked you was in terms of these provisions that are usually used, and all of us in the field, day in and day out, are, and I am sure they all, the questions also refer to that, is the whole question of whether an assembly is permissible or not. And the fact that you have the police today using
144,
yes, but provisions of the Police Act,
yeah, take
that, and these are religiously renewed every 15 days.
Yes.
We had a right to information petition, a series of right to information petitions. Sorry, one second. I'm sorry. A series of right to information petitions filed with all the SPs and all the commissioners of police in Tamil Nadu. And the result was that we were able to see that this was a religiously carried out exercise by the police. And therefore, there were in a year, perhaps 3 days in a subdivision where you could perhaps protest without permission, which is almost that you have to go to the khaki to get permission for a protest.
Yeah.
It is that is the law.
Yes.
And that is where you have problems.
Mm-hmm.
And then the problems are whether you gave an application, the problem is whether there's a proof of the application being made, and the story continues like this. So these are the day in and day out ordinary problems of movement leaders in relation to the freedom to assemble and protest and express our dissent. Thank you very much, Kalpana. I just wanted participants to know that we will be sharing with them something. Because the question was asked, does our law sync with the international standards? And I want to share with you something which we will pass on to you, which is as recent as the 6th of May 2020. From the special rapporteur on the promotion and protection. Are you able to see?
Yeah.
On the special rapporteur on the promotion and protection of human rights and fundamental freedoms while countering terrorism, that is one. The working group on arbitrary detention, the special rapporteur on the promotion and protection of the right to freedom of opinion and expression, the special rapporteur on the right to freedom of peaceful assembly and of association, the special rapporteur on the situation of human rights defenders, the special rapporteur on the independence of judges and lawyers, the special rapporteur on minority issues, the special rapporteur on right to privacy, and the special rapporteur on the freedom of religion or belief. These are a group of 10 special procedures who have come together to ensure that this statement is produced. And this is a joint statement. And the joint statement is on the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act that you referred to just now, and how they are, whether they fall in line or not with India's own commitments to the international mechanisms, international standards, to the convention that we have signed and ratified, as well as other standards that have been established. And so therefore, they refer to the ICCPR, they refer to the UDHR, and I will be sharing this with you. And this was passed on to the government recently as a joint, this was a press release as late as 6th of May of their joint statement. So this is how to see that whether things are in shape or not. And while international mechanisms are willing to look at the legalities of such legislations, we have a white elephant that we have created among ourselves, which we call the National Human Rights Commission, and their bodies in different states, where they remain totally silent. And they are extremely happy with this lockdown, because that legitimizes their lockdown. They would always like to be silent and under lockdown, and this is a good excuse for them to be locked down. So this is, we will finish the day with this. We are already slightly late, 5 minutes late. I want to thank Kalpana for having been with us. Saila is still there. Both your subjects were definitely interlinked, but we wanted them to be held separately. And I'm so happy, Kalpana, that you are able to give a perspective that normally we don't take. It is only people like you who are linked to the movements, who are able to strategically present to ourselves what this freedom of association is and what all is not freedom of association. And that, I think, today was very, very clearly brought out by you. Thank you very, very much. Participants, get ready. Afternoon, we have we start with the right to love. So don't be late. Don't be late. There are many people who want to know what this right to love is. It may be late in your lives to realize what it is, but it is
never
right.
Too late. Never too late.
Never too late. Never too late. So 3:45 this afternoon, and we will start with two sessions this afternoon. Thank you. Thank you very much, Saila. Thank you very much, Kalpana.
Thank you. Bye, Saila.
Thank you.